OTAN, Outreach and Technical Assistance Network.
Well, welcome everyone. We're at our session today with using Canvas with ABE programs to help us get started with that, and using learning tools called LTIs. We'll get all the details about that. We had a bit of a rocky start here. I forgot to turn on the recording, so I'm going to go ahead right over to Jamie, and I'll let her introduce herself, and I'll get us back to her slide. We just had introductions, so everybody will reintroduce themselves when they start their section.
Again, my name is Jamie Nash, director at Tamil Pius Adult School, and I appreciate the participants putting their Canvas experience in the chat. Sounds like we have a range here from want to learn more about it to have downloaded some shells and I'm kind of getting started with the program in our school. So that's great. So that's really just helpful for all of us to know here as we present on this topic. So next slide, please. All right. So, you know, one of the things that I've noticed, I imagine you guys on the panel and the participants here today, is that a lot of TDLS this time around, we're talking about Canvas, that it's being widely used, not just in the adult school world, not just in the university world and high school setting, but now more so in the adult ed realm as well. So when the pandemic hit, there were some schools, some high schools, and some adult schools that were online using Canvas. But really what I saw as an administrator is that there was a trend to bring in Canvas, whether it was my own kids' high school experience or the adult schools, to really make learning accessible, because it looked like we were going to be online for a while. So it's a really great platform to use with students. It's engaging. It's widely used, whether it's in the university or community college system or the high school system. So in another presentation I was in this morning, one of the educators in that presentation went so far as to say that if we're not introducing our students to Canvas, we're doing them a disservice. And actually, I tend to agree with that, because I think it's important that we expose our students to what is being used in adult education, and also in the world of work or university or even trainings within university. So not only does Canvas build that exposure, but it also builds digital literacy skills with our student population. And I'm wondering if some of you on the participant list are wondering, well, you know, Canvas is really just for students at the intermediate level, VSL and, you know, ABE GED levels. However, I would ask for you to consider that I think we have a responsibility to all of our students, to all of our adults, to build their tech skills no matter where their level is, because that's the world that we live in. And that's been especially apparent as COVID has sort of taken over the world. And many of the presentations in TDLS have been by educators in adult schools who are working with the beginning levels of ESL. So I think there's a lot of possibility out there, and I'm excited to actually bring in more Canvas, not just to the ABE level, but even to our other levels as well. So let's go to the next slide.
Hey, Jamie.
Yeah.
Also, you know, just to reiterate too, when this says, you know, user-friendly platform, this is a user-friendly platform on multiple levels. Most of our students, because we've seen data out of our student surveys, they have a smartphone. They own a device. They use it. Not only that, they have tablets, or, you know, yes, there are issues sometimes with access to broadband, but we should be able to meet our students where they have those devices, and Canvas is wonderfully compatible with all of those different devices. So back to you, Jamie.
Thank you. And thank you for saying that, because it also reminded me that, you know, we're hearing a lot now, just, you know, as global citizens of you know, what the work, how the workforce has changed and mm-hmm. will continue to change, you know, with the pandemic parameters. And so many of us have been working from home or now starting to come back on to school sites or work sites. But you're also hearing in the news that, you know, work from home options or study from home options are increasing. So it's another important reason and component for us all to think about as we create our programs for adult learners is you know, how are we going to meet that challenge? How are we going to offer that accessibility to our students so that they don't just have to be on site to get the instruction? And so that would be another reason to use. If you're a creative type, I struggle with that, but you can get so creative in Canvas, from the design of your platform and the look of your class to the way that you create and roll out assignments and graphics. It's a wonderful place to organize all your amazing materials. If you're in the ABE field, you know that there's very little out there for us. And the materials that we find, we have to struggle and work really hard to find. And they're from a lot of different places. We don't just have one book that we can use. So what's nice about the Canvas portal is that you can use that portal, you can use your class as a way to organize your wonderful materials. You can do it by module, you can do it by week, you can do it by subject area, and you can move it all around in the course. So there's just a lot of really great opportunities. The other piece is that the Canvas portal, as long as you have Wi-Fi, it's accessible. So we could have students that, you know, we all know that we have students that, you know, take a couple weeks off, 3 weeks off, sometimes longer to go visit family out of the country, or they did. And now this is a way that your students can still stay engaged and continue to be with family or go places. And that includes with, you know, if there's childcare issues on a given day. So there's just really great opportunities to have both synchronous and asynchronous opportunities for learning. Yeah, Penny's saying that students can go hang out at Starbucks and other places, the libraries, other places where Wi-Fi is better to do work. And so that's, you know, those are just some of the other things to think about why you might want to implement Canvas at your site. All right, next slide.
And can I add one thing, Jamie?
Absolutely.
At the, you know, you have on your list here accessible and paperless. I think that it's really important to understand we're not talking just about students being able to get to Canvas and be able to manipulate the materials there, but it's also accessible in the terms of 508 compliance. So if you have the needs, if you have students that have special needs or they have a disability of one kind or another, Canvas has already built in the necessary tools to make that navigation piece much easier for them. So I tend to tout that one because I'm very much about, you know, equal access and or equivalent experiences for learners so they can actually be able to get to those materials. That's the access via broadband piece, and then have them accessible if they have any type of, you know, a visual impairment or a hearing impairment, that they can have a similar experience as the rest of the learners in the classroom.
Yeah, and before we go to the next slide, thank you for saying that too, Penny, because that reminded me that really you can make your online, you know, your Canvas course very engaging for students. If you give them homework and they turn in an assignment, you can provide written feedback on that assignment. You can provide verbal through the use of, you know, audio feedback. You can create discussions within a course or a module for students. You can, instead of, you know, imagining yourself in the physical classroom setting, asking like an opener question, you can do that online and solicit the same kind of feedback and discussion as you would in person. It just looks a little different. And so there's just a lot of different possibilities that are there. And it's a matter of getting started. You're not going to be as amazing online if you've never taught online as you are in person. There's a building process. It's a journey to get there, but you'll get there. So that's just something to think about as well.
Hey, Jamie, I just want to support what you're saying about the participation, the students, if you do an online thing and discussion, some students who would not maybe be brave enough to participate face-to-face actually will participate online, mm-hmm. where it's a different playing field. So you're adding something that is very rich for certain types of students. So I think that's a real benefit. The shyer student, for example,
right.
might not raise their hand or speak up face to face, online has sort of more equal opportunity.
Really good point. Really, really good point. All right, let's go to the next slide. You know, one thing I did forget, for any of you on the listening in now, if you are a Google Classroom teacher user, I would highly, and you haven't started Canvas yet, I would highly encourage you to just play with it, because I think you'll find that you like, once you get through that learning curve, and there is a learning curve, that you'll like Canvas probably more than you like Google Classroom. There's a lot more flexibility within the platform than I found there to be with Google Classroom. And I'm not disparaging Google Classroom at all. I think it's a great tool. We use it here also, but I just think it's another thought in terms of, you know, your usage, your implementation of Canvas if you decide to go that route. So let's talk about the LTI tools. These are online publishers, online tools that you may already use in your adult school, that perhaps you've given students account, like in, for instance, Newzella. You know, perhaps students already have Newzella as part of your teaching program within an ABE program outside of Canvas. Within Canvas, they have different publishers and programs that you can incorporate right into your Canvas class and assign, instead of giving, you know, multiple emails and logins and accounts. It can all be done in one place. And I think more and more publishers for adult schools are understanding that Canvas is sort of the direction that we're all going to be going. So I think we'll see more and more of them that decide to figure out how to integrate with Canvas. Let's see. So, and I know Zoe's going to talk a little bit about that. I know Mary Ann's going to talk a little bit about that. I will be very candid here that, you know, I am just still learning about LTIs and even how to incorporate them and what that really looks like. And I'm finding sometimes that the publishers and programs materials that we use and really count on don't yet have an LTI embed code. So we're kind of working on that as well. We're working through some of those issues.
Jamie?
Yes, go ahead.
I'm a believer in, kind of that drip water torture or the squeaky wheel. If teachers and administrators start pinging on these publishers more and more about, you know, look, I want an LTI because I like using your stuff, but if I can't make it work for my learners, to give them the learners the flexibility of having access to this material, then I can vote with my feet and go to another publisher. I think that you're right that publishers are getting the word. I mean, there are many, many, many of these learning tools, the LTIs out there. It's just sometimes, you know, you don't know if you don't ask, and you don't know if you don't find the resources to help you explore them. That's why these types of sessions are really helpful, because we can talk about specifics, which is what we will do here today. But please expand your thought process of thinking about, well, what do I currently use and what do I have available to me? Could I integrate my textbook with what I could do in Canvas, along with all of those other wonderful tools that allow for feedback and the student voice in so many different ways. And then you still get to use what you've invested in terms of that textbook. Because I'm a true believer in that squeaky wheel thing. So I just wanted to throw that out there, because a lot of times we get kind of stuck in, well, it takes so long for new textbooks to get approved or whatever the case may be. You know, there may be options here that could be very valuable to your agency in providing more of these LTIs in a Canvas instance that you're using.
So I'll get off my soapbox. Sorry.
Thank you, Penny, so much. And I will say, just having listened into an earlier session today, that Corona Norco Adult School, they have done some really good work in bringing LTIs into their Canvas world. And so Sean and Pamela and, you know, some of the other people on the listening in, I would highly recommend also, if you can, go back and listen to that recording if it's available, or reach out to them as well. Because I think they're kind of doing what Penny's suggesting, which is, you know, making sure that the publishers that they use are getting LTI codes, and then they're finding new ones if they don't. So they're a little farther ahead where we are, but I'm hoping we'll get there as well. And I've been very thankful. You're going to hear from Zoe in a little bit. I've been very thankful for Zoe's tenacity and for her drive. You know, she's really asked us to add LTIs to her Canvas course on several occasions. And so she's learning as she goes, and she's doing a great job. So I'm going to go on to the final slide. So next slide, please. So if you have not considered joining the Canvas pilot with OTAN, you definitely want to do that. Even if you're just playing with it, even if you think only one teacher is going to use it, it's just important to get started and to, you know, just try. They've made, you know, the pilot very inexpensive, and it's very adult ed user friendly, even at the lowest levels of tech skill. At least that's been our experience. So I would just say it's important to get started. Don't let the tech piece scare you out of just starting. And, you know, I think I anticipate, and Penny can certainly weigh in here, that next year there, or maybe even starting as early as this summer, there will be a tremendous amount of training for new agencies that come on and join the pilot program. Go ahead.
No, I mean, I just to let folks know, I know we don't have a huge audience here, but if your adult school does not have Canvas, please know that California Distance Learning Cooperative is meant to provide all adult schools with an instance or their own Canvas platform, their own Canvas gateway. We pay for it, and we pay for the initial 50 licenses for you. And then after that, then if you need more licenses, we have a memorandum of understanding that we will enter into with your agency, and you can purchase additional licenses at an extraordinarily low rate. Yes. And you can get more information. I put the email address also in the chat. Please go. This is where you can go to your administrator, because an administrator has to be the one that signs up for this and approves this, because we have to have somebody who has that, you know, that fiduciary responsibility. They're the ones that can spend the money. We get lots of wonderfully enthusiastic teachers that want to do something like this and say, sign me up, but they're not authorized to spend money. So they go to your administrators and, you know, keep pinging on them and bring them chocolate chip cookies or something and say, you know, look, I think this is really good for our learners, because it is. And it's an amazing deal for adult schools across the state. So we highly encourage anyone who's not signed up yet. And it's no big rush. Don't think you have to like get started and do it immediately. You do have the time. We put you through training. We get you all set up. And, you've got now from now until whenever you want to start using Canvas with your students. You might want to work with your teachers first and then bring your students on, you know, the next semester. You have that flexibility. So I strongly encourage you to get in touch with us to learn more. And we've got resources for you that are a quick read and gives you the baseline of what's going on that you can share with your administrators. Or if you are if you email us at that canvas@scoe.net, we will be sure to get that information out to you as soon as possible. So I will then turn it back to Jamie. Jamie, where are we going next?
Well, I think I'm done. I would just encourage you to keep putting your questions in the chat. I loved Sean's question, which is, I'm a Google Classroom user. Will it integrate with Canvas? And Penny answered that yes, it will. And, you know, so keep those questions flowing if you have them. And thank you.
Definitely.
Moving on.
And we're moving on to Zoe, right? Your perspective from getting started with Canvas. Do you want me to go to the next slide?
Yes. Why don't we? Yeah. Hi, everyone. My name is Zoe Miner, and I'm a teacher at Tamil Pais Adult School. I teach a multi-subject high school equivalency GED test prep course to ABE and ASE students. Can I advance myself? Or
yep.
Let's see. Oh, good. Yay. So I have ABE and ASE students at Tamil Pais Adult School. We do high school equivalency GED test prep. And so I got, as most of us,
There you go. You got it.
Yeah, okay, that is right. All right. So as most of us did, I got drawn into the virtual teaching and learning universe when schools went remote in 2020. I did start with Google Classroom also, which for me also was a learning curve. And it took me a while to get comfortable there and get my students comfortable there. And I didn't take it too seriously because at first I thought the move to distance learning would be temporary and everybody would be going back to in-person. And it seemed very clunky at first to be online compared to the visceral in-person classroom experience that I was used to. So I didn't put a lot of focus. I just did enough to get by with the Google Classroom. But I started to see that there were advantages also to the online environment for teaching and learning. So I dove in feet first because I had to, but my head was still in the paper world. So I was like scanning all my favorite worksheets and trying to, just transfer everything the way I was doing it before, because I had a lot of good materials, what I thought, but some of them didn't transfer as well to the digital environment, but I was playing around and starting to just explore this new virtual world of teaching and learning. And even though I had been exposed to quite a bit of tech training, our district is pretty generous with training opportunities. So over the years, I was exposed to different ed tech training opportunities. But even so, once we had to do it actually for real and didn't have the option to be in person with the students and show them in person, I and my students have to admit was often seriously confused and lost and overwhelmed with all the new vocabulary, all the new ways for doing things, the new algorithms. And the new apps and all the possibilities, it was overwhelming. So I did spend a lot of time exploring, but mostly stumbling and fumbling around in the ed tech world and bringing my students along with me, but they were very patient and we've all been in this process of learning together and the learning curve. But the ed tech world, as much as I, put my effort into really trying to learn, it seemed like it was growing tentacles faster than I could even begin to keep up with. And so it was just, and it still seems that way, I have to admit, that it's just, there's a lot of new things coming up as well as the things that are already in place. So my learning curve was, and it still is, on its trajectory. Let's see. Yeah. So pretty much started with blissful ignorance. I didn't know what I didn't know. And I was fine with that until I had to kind of move to the next level. Blissful ignorance. And then, sometimes called unconscious incompetence. But then once I realized what I, needed to know, but didn't know, it was, a little bit of panic there and very daunting, the magnitude and the expanse of what I didn't know and needed to know. It was overwhelming. And now I'm moving along. So I can't say that I'm at the conscious, competent place quite yet, but getting there and striving towards getting to that. And I'd love to be able to achieve the unconscious competence with the flow where I can get to it, where I and my students can focus on the content and use our tech skills to enhance, not impede our learning process and our learning experience. Because I do feel that a lot of time and effort has been spent on just learning the tech both of us, the students and myself included. And, you know, I do think that, you know, getting myself first out of the fixed mindset of, you know, oh no, this is secondary to in-person is better, to just the growth mindset of, oh, look at all the possibilities here. And maybe there are some benefits here that I haven't explored quite yet. So I'm trying to just stay open to all the possibilities and finding that there are a lot of positives. And especially for our adult students who do have the challenges of childcare and, you know, time schedules and transportation and all of that.
Zoe?
Yes.
I have a question for you. First of all, sure. I love this four stages of competency. I love that, you know, willingness of someone who admits to this unconscious incompetent, because we've all been there. And I'm just curious, I know this trajectory can be quite steep, or it can be kind of a level gain over time. And at your point in this stage is that you right now, can you identify, or is there anything that you would go and say, well, okay, I would have done this better or different or something if I had just done X beforehand? Is there any additional supports, resources, things that you think that you, if you had known about them at the time, that would have been helped you move along this four stages?
Well, you know, the thing that got me that really confused me at the beginning, and maybe it was because I wasn't really organized in how I, you know, sort of approached it in terms of the trainings and all of that. But the vocabulary, like, or just the jargon, like a page in Canvas, and I'm used to the page on my Mac, you know, and files, you know, mean something different than the files on my computer. Just some of the jargon confused me in that way. So I had to, in the beginning, just kind of get my terms straight, you know, define terms. So maybe it was more, you know, on my user error on my side, you know, to just really approach it maybe with a little more organization. I didn't realize what I didn't know. And so, and how, you know, just the sort of, it was this vast expanse of new learning that had to happen. And so I'm not sure if there was something anyone else besides myself could have done different.
You know, that's very compelling to me, what you just said, because it kind of lends itself to some empathy for our own learners, right? Yeah. Because we go through that experience. Absolutely. But then secondarily, it's like, oh my gosh, of course, you know, let's describe the situation. Let's describe what we have before we're tossing people, you know, into the frying pan on top of the fire. And I ask that because, you know, OTAN does a lot of training, and sometimes we kind of miss that forest for the trees, not intentionally, but because we might make assumptions that we shouldn't make. And I really like hearing that point of view from you of, you know, having a better idea of, like, when we do some of these trainings, especially with brand newbie teachers, we have other elements that should be considered. I mean, we might make an assumption, and I'm just speaking off the cuff here, we might make assumptions that somebody has a great deal of technology experience because, golly, they have an interest in using Canvas. Well, that's not always the case. You stated quite clearly that you were very used to being in the paper world, and now you had to convert to digital. And I think that journey in and of itself is commendable. I mean, I just want to give you super rounds of applause, because it's obvious of what you're doing is working with your learners, and you're learning, and you're comfortable with that discomfort. I guess that's as far as I could go, but I really appreciate that insight, because I like I said, I do like these four stages of competency and understanding where you are in that in those stages. So thank you.
And can I just interrupt here and just say that she has a great attendance. Zoe has a great attendance, and Zoe has given our office some ideas about how we need to enroll new students. And what we need, what preparation they need before they get into her class. And while we always don't always get it right, you know, we have listened to her guidance, and it's helped us reshape how we enroll new students with the mindset that they're going to be getting Canvas. And I also forgot to mention with Zoe is that, you know, we hired Zoe on this year to be a remote only instructor. to deal with,
wow,
you know, the pandemic parameters and the fact that our students wanted online only. And so Canvas, although it, you know, it felt very large, and it is very large, you know, Zoe's taken it on and made it pretty doable for our students. We do not get a lot of complaints that it's something they can't do or they don't understand why we're using. So I wouldn't call it seamless because nothing new is, but it's been a really nice addition for us.
Thank you, Jamie. You guys have been very supportive and, you know, just being receptive to my suggestions. And, you know, we're all learning. We definitely are all learning. Like even that video, Jamie, that you just shared in your presentation about just that intro to Canvas. In the beginning, I didn't even know what Canvas was. I would have, I'm sure I could have found that video, but I didn't. And so I just now, I liked how it just was a very basic overview of even what it was. In the beginning, I was trying to figure out even what is it? How can I use it? So I'd like to be able to share that video with the students so they know too what it is and how we're using it.
Perfect, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So we all need to, you know, just get more comfortable. And I'm always telling the students, you know, that they have to be uncomfortable with that sense of not knowing. And so I got to experience it firsthand here. moving along. So I've been using Canvas since September 2021. So just this last couple semesters. And where I am so far is I was able to create my Canvas course. I've got some modules going. I'm still working with, you know, the particulars, but I was at least able to get myself and students on there. I still have a lot of questions, a lot more to learn, lots of hours of trial and error in there, clicking around, and lots of my, you know, my own user error and frustration, stumbling around, like I said. But I was able to create this Canvas course, and I'm still working on it. And I was able to publish it.
Now I'm
at the point where I can, even though I'm still daunted and confused at times, I'm excited about all the possibilities and for myself, for my students, and for the potential of education in general, because it has really opened up possibilities here, and especially for access and just ability to students to move at their own pace, teachers to be more creative. I love being creative. That's why part of it is, you know, I've spent a lot of time because I'm, you know, just looking for the right little image or the right, you know, just scouring the internet looking for, you know, digital resources and all that. So that's taken me a lot of time and still does, but it's kind of fun to do. And I think the students are kind of getting into it as well. We're still struggling with, you know, the assignments, the quizzes, I haven't quite figured out. And also
need some help, Zoe?
The next slide.
Sure. There we go.
There we go. Okay. So there is this thing called, which I didn't know at first what LTI was, LMS, LTI, again, all the all those acronyms. But LTI, Learning Tool Interoperability. And, you know, at first you're just in Canvas and I didn't even want to add anything because it was just too complicated as it was. But then little by little, it became clear that it would be nice to be able to have the students work on a Google Doc in the Canvas itself, and then that I would be able to then access it there, comment on it, return it to them, instead of the way we were doing it where they were sharing with me by email and then my email box would get filled with student work, and that was also not manageable. So the fact that they can do work in Google and then submit their work within the Canvas platform is really nice. I've done that a few times. It doesn't always work, but I'm still working on how to do it better. And then I've also worked with Juice. Students are able to access Juice right out of the Canvas out of the Canvas course, and Newzella and CK12. I'm just starting to look at that. And like I say, it doesn't always work. And a lot of times it's on my end, just not an, I just need more training and more practice. But it, the fact that it's there and that there might be even more, and I know there will be more different learning tools that we'll be able to use. It's amazing that, you know, we've come this far. I mean, just in terms of the ability to for students to learn online like this is pretty great. Now that I'm, you know, a little more comfortable, I can say that. At first I was, you know, way not as positive in terms of my outlook, but I knew it was there. I knew the possibilities were there. And that's what actually created a lot of the frustration, is that I knew that, you know, there was a lot I could do and I wasn't doing, and I knew that I can do it a lot better and I wasn't doing it as well as I thought I should. So yeah, it was all that part of it. You know, you can see what you can do, but then aren't able to do. So that's part of it. So far, you know, as you saw, I created the modules, I've created some lessons in there, just starting to work with, you know, assigning assignments and quizzes. I know there's a lot more features that on Canvas that I could use, but I'm not going to go, I'm trying to go slow. And, you know, just getting this far has been quite a journey and an adventure.
Awesome.
And yeah, so it, but it kind of reminds me of, you know, I just got a new car recently and it's got all these buttons on the dashboard that I have no idea what they are, but I know enough to drive the car, and that's what I need to do right now. And eventually I might, you know, really dive into that user manual and find out what all those buttons are about. But for now, I can drive the car, and that's what I need to do. And once I get a little more comfortable, I will look into all that stuff. And but I'm not there yet. I'm still just moving along. And then okay. And then my final slide here is just looking at, you know, where we are, where I am actually with Canvas and moving forward. So for needs, I would say that, you know, myself and teachers both, and students rather, but also other teachers, all of us, need additional training and tech support just to, and the time to integrate and apply what we learned. Because in the past, I would, you know, take these ed tech workshops and webinars and this and that, but then, you know, go back to teaching the way I was teaching because that's what I had time for. And so, you know, we've been kind of forced into this virtual learning universe. And so it's given us time to apply here and there and try things out. But I'm not quite sure I'm there where it's totally integrated and all my past teaching experience can really be effectively, you know, presented to my students, because I'm still, you know, fumbling around with the tech part of things, but I'm getting there. I'm excited about the new possibilities here in teaching and learning. And then our challenges will still be student access to devices and internet, but we're trying to overcome that with just, you know, loaning devices out. Having, now that we have in person, we're having students come to the school site and then take my remote class from the school site so they can use the Wi-Fi and the devices there. So that's one way that we're overcoming that. And then of course the learning curve and just the mindset of all of us, you know, just being willing to move into this new world and, you know, just being positive about our experience and moving forward. Anyone have any questions or comments?
Zoe, I was just gonna make a connection when Jamie was showing her slides, and I think she had a slide where she talked about single sign-on. And that is one of the big advantages when you were showing the various resources that you can now link to from your course. It makes it a lot easier for the learner if they don't have to log in again each time they link out to something. And that's one of the jobs that the Canvas LTI connection can do. So it can make it a lot more smooth for the learner to just go into whether it's Google Docs or Juice or Newzella or the other ones you mentioned. And I just think that's a really big benefit, because for all of us, just remembering our login name and password is really one of the big hassles of working online. So I just wanted to make that connection in case people hadn't thought about the single sign-on benefit.
That's a very good point, Penny, because that's where we were getting into troubles. It was like, okay, now we're here on the Zoom class. Let's go to Newzella or let's go somewhere else. And then I'd lose students because they couldn't find their other screen. And so if we're, so if it's all there, it's one place to go. And then just the ability of, you know, students who miss a class or, you know, being able to work on things during the week when we are out of, you know, not in class, I think is really, really a big benefit.
Also, I just want to commend you on all the work you've done, because I met you a little bit earlier along this journey. And your course looks beautiful. And one of the things I've learned is that when one person has created a nice course, that can be shared sometimes as a template or a course that gets copied. And I think it's just helpful for anyone listening to know that every time someone makes a step like you have, you are creating a path for someone else who, if they want to teach like you do, you know, Jamie and the other administrators can actually use that and build on that. And you've just come such a long way. I think it really opens the path for others.
Thank you. Now my, you know, one of my, now that I feel a little more comfortable with, you know, creating the modules and, you know, the pages and those kinds of things. Now my bigger challenge is, you know, finding and designing the lessons that are, you know, really work on the screen as opposed to in an in-person how I was used to. So that's been, you know, it's interesting to, you know, explore those possibilities, but, you know, it's not like I have a huge bank like I had before of just materials I can pull on, you know, depending on who my students were. So just creating those, you know, those modules and the lessons is part of what I would like more time to do and all that.
Well, one of the other things I learned from you and Jamie is, and I hadn't really thought about it this way, but once you have your class or your course in Canvas, you can use it face-to-face in a classroom as a presentation tool too, and just link to whatever it is you want to do with your class. I mean, Jamie, you explained that to me because we were talking about Juice, I think, or it was Rebecca, one of your teachers. So it's amazing once you get it all together. It doesn't have to be completely online. It can be hybrid or high flex, or, you know, they're just, it's not taking away any of the flexibility you have to use those materials in a variety of ways.
Yeah, I'm finding it's sort of like an interactive textbook almost for the students, because I'm putting a lot of reference materials in there so that if they forget things like the rules of, you know, order of operations or anything, they can just go there and click on there and remember. So textbook. I mean, it's like a textbook or a bookshelf. It's a lot of different ways you can look at it, but yeah, just sort of switching the mindset to the digital.
And I wanted to highlight one of the comments that Linda just made in the chat, which is that the classes are reusable. Mm-hmm. So what's amazing is all the work that Zoe's putting in on this class. Right. And she has a couple different ones going, but let's just say she selected one and she's giving all her attention to it. You can copy it, you can move it over and start a new class, move things around, delete stuff, quiet stuff. It's an incredible time saver, as Penny just mentions, but all the amazing work that you do for this particular one course is, it's just going to get better year after year, time after time. And that's amazing. That's the fun part about this.
Right. You've laid so much groundwork. And I mean, back to your slide, Zoe, it's a process, you know, and you're going through a lot of stages, and it's just going to get more interesting and richer as you go forward. So cool.
So like I said, I'm just trying, and I think we're all trying to get to the point where the tech is in the background and we can focus on the content and the learning. But it is a learning curve, and you know what we're putting in now, though, will pay off. That's the hope anyway.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you so much, Zoe, for sharing your work and what you've been doing at Mount Tamalpais there. It's just amazing.
Thank you. You're welcome.
And I think we're going to move on so you can learn a little more about at least one LTI tool. And this is something that Zoe is using. And there are many, many others, as we've mentioned several times before. But we wanted to take a deeper dive into this tool that I will let Marianne talk about. And I'll advance us to the next slide. And Marianne, do you want control?
Sure. I think I know what to do. I'll
get it. Hold on here. You should be able to get it now.
Here we go.
I'll keep my hands off my mouse.
Okay, you're an amazing pilot of all this technology. Well, really, this is, I'm very happy to talk about JUICE. I worked on a four-year grant from the Department of Education, and what we built, we decided was so valuable and could be so useful to learners, adult learners, in many different contexts that I have a little startup company, and I'm delighted to be piloting it with Tamil Pius and other schools in the California Distance Learning Cooperative, and also with the NEDP High School External Diploma Program. So, but we're a great example of what Jamie and Zoe are talking about. And LTI is really just a standard interface, just a plug-in interface, just like the reason all our lights work in our sockets. And they did this in education to reduce the complexity that Zoe is talking about of having all these different products that, you know, you might want to use at the same time. And it is a fairly new standard, but not that new. It's been around for probably 7 or 8, maybe 10 years. So we integrated JUICE with this standard interface or programming interface. And that means that you can use a product like ours, and I'll tell you a little bit about it, inside Canvas or any other learning management system that supports the standard. So just let's, you know, for an example, so JUICE is a readiness library that provides very rich tutorial, interactive and game-based learning of basic academic skills. And we're just looking at a view. I'm not planning to do a live demo, although if we have time, we can look at it if you want to. So all of the things that you see there in this library, you know, you can link to and link to any part of it. So, and you can add that link. And when we looked at Zoe's class, you saw her curriculum there. You can link to those things. Sorry, can everybody hear me okay?
All right. Yes.
Okay, great. I'm just gonna make sure I go to the next one and see if I can get that to work. Okay, I think I got it. There we go. All right, so just a little bit more about JUICE. When you go to a particular skill in JUICE, there are many different ways for a learner to practice. A teacher could use some of these resources in class to present or have an interactive class activity, which Zoe and Jamie are familiar with, and Penny too. About JUICE, our goal is to motivate and engage learners at different skill levels and support them where they are and let them do as much, as little or as much that as they need in a tutorial experience online to get the help they need in practice. And the example I like to give is, if you want to help me become a better basketball player, you're not going to sit and talk to me about it. You're going to throw me the ball, make me go out, and make me start shooting hoops. And you know that I won't become a better player unless I play. And that's what we try to do in JUICE. We try to engage the learner in working through a real world problem and applying skills to solve them. So it could be in the future adapted for any skill context, but you know, we tried to pick things that adults care about, like carpeting in your house for mathematics. And that's why you need to be able to understand how to do percentages, for example. So learners can use these overviews, try it tutorials, and I don't think you can see too well, but they give different real world problem solving contexts, or challenge games, which are very short, sort of 3 questions at a time with interactive feedback. And in JUICE, our philosophy is if you get the answer wrong, you just didn't get it right yet. So we don't tell you you're wrong. We say, hey, good try. Here's some feedback and why that answer is wrong. Try again. And then the idea is to keep them going until they have success. Go to the next question. Those little games you see there are only 3 questions each, but you can play many times, 7 or 8 times and get new questions each time. So that's just an example. JUICE has a lot of flexibility. it's not really like a textbook in the sense that you start in chapter one and go to chapter whatever, but it's a resource for classes like Zoe's teaching. When she knows students need help in particular skill areas, she can link to JUICE, or she can link to the whole library and let them find what they go to what they are working on at that time. So, because Zoe, I think you're in a you have a multi-level class, so that's actually super challenging to teach, right?
Correct. And I have just linked the whole JUICE for the students as just another place they can practice.
Yeah. So what's interesting, also our philosophy is really about building confidence as a learner to take chances and try, and then get that supportive feedback so you can figure out what it is you need to learn, and then you can practice. But again, stepping back, so let's, clicking the right way here. There we go. So how does it work in your Canvas? And I know a lot of people are getting ready to work in Canvas. So your Canvas administrator will just get a couple of codes from me or a company like me. And it'll be sort of, techie things, a consumer key and a shared secret. And this is what Jamie and I did. So we would give you those codes, you, the Canvas administrator, and you go through kind of a step-by-step process. It's totally standard. It's part of what Canvas is and how it works. And you install what is called the external app, like JUICE or some of those others. And then once it's installed, when a teacher like Zoe goes in to work on assignments and a course, they'll see the option to get a link to create a link to an external tool. They can get into JUICE, copy the link they want. They could link to a game, to a module, to a particular skill like how to improve your capitalization and grammar, or how to write a topic sentence in a paragraph. And then she could paste that into the Canvas assignment, apply whatever setting she wants, and then save that. And then that link, when the student comes in, the student would link directly to it. Another difference with LTIs is the student, it's a personalized experience. So when that student links from, let's say, Zoe's course into JUICE, JUICE knows that it's Marianne and saves the information about Marianne. And that's just one of the characteristics of most LTI products. Although I think some of them probably just give you permission to access whatever you want. In the case of JUICE, it really is a personalized learning environment. And JUICE can track the answers and save information and let students see what they did before, go back and continue and things like that. Does that make sense? Any questions so far? Definitely, I'll try to check the chat, but if you guys have a question, please chime in.
There's nothing in the chat yet.
Okay. So this is just showing what we just talked about. This is just a teeny tiny version of kind of what Zoe showed us in her course. So, this would be the link that the teacher set up and put in an assignment. And when the student clicks the link, it just opens in a new browser tab. So you're getting to take a peek at one of the JUICE modules on basic math skills, finding percentage, percent of a number, and so on. And as you can see, all of these skills are being presented in the context of home improvement problem solving. And you'll also notice there's a little game here called the challenge wheel game. And this reminds me of something you said, Joey, which is, Zoe, when you said, I didn't know what I didn't know, or now I know what I didn't know. And of course, as a learner, that's really a huge problem because you really don't know necessarily what all these skills are, and you're not sure what you know and what you don't know. So these particular games on JUICE modules are designed to help you know what you don't know and then send you back to where you could work on that when you have time. And you can come back later in products like JUICE and work on it when you do have time.
So, Marianne,
yeah.
Can I admit something?
Yes.
Okay. I separated from mathematics ages ago. Okay. So when you showed me JUICE, I was able to come in here and go, I need to figure out a percentage increase on some data that I was working on.
Great.
And it worked.
That's fantastic. That is, well, that's that, you know what, I confess, I was more of a languages geek and also not so much of a math geek, but really, I think you're making the point at any age, at any stage of become mastering a skill, we need to go back and refresh. So I'm guessing the students in Zoe's class are a wide range of ages, and some of them may even be as old as I am. It's going to be true as we all go forward in the world. We have to keep refreshing our skills. So, but thank you, Penny. That's great. I love it. But the nice thing is, I want to use your example. You can get a little bit of help or a lot of help. And that leads me, I think, to my next slide. So let me see if I put this in here. Yeah, okay. So this is a little peek at some data from a pilot we're running. It's not like Zoe's class or anything. It's actually from the NEDP program, students who are using JUICE to work on specific skills for their high school diploma. And these students are in New York, and they've come into JUICE at different times. But even so, what you're seeing on the left here is the number of hours that they worked in JUICE, and these are the individual students. And they've all started at different times. So maybe some of these students just got access to JUICE, but some of them have had access for several months. And the point, I think my takeaway is a couple of things. Some people need a lot of help. They need, back to my basketball court example, they need to work with that ball skills for a long time to build their confidence. And other students just need a little refresh. And Penny, I just know in your case, you just needed a little refresh and you probably got it very quickly. But some of the students that have been working on their skills in JUICE, even in a couple of months, have spent over 10 hours. And others, you know, there's just a range. But what also I think is really important, and we're all different kinds of learners, and we all like to make our own choices. And the overview is more like an interactive textbook, and it has audio narration. So you can go at a really slow pace. You can have it read to you and read along. You'll see your examples. You'll get the explanation of percents or grammar or writing. And that's one way to learn. And in our design, prototyping, some students said, I like to read. I would always start with the overview. But other students said, I hate to read. And they would always start with a game. And the game is how they figured out what they know and what they don't know and what they need to work on. And so I think a graph like this, and I presented this also just so we can see all these learners are so different. When you use an online learning environment, you can learn so much about the learning process simply by looking at how they're spending time and how much time they're spending. And as people who work on a product, of course, it helps us know, well, is this thing that we do valuable, and is it valuable in the same way to every learner? So I used it more as an example of how learning data can also really help you as an educator make choices and decisions that will help your learners, you know, get where they want to go. So that's my, I think that's my last slide, Penny. You can double check me on that, but I hope that gives people a little bit of a sense. Oh yeah, this is just kind of a summary of how LTIs are very flexible. And when you make them available in your class, more along the themes of what others have already said, those links and those resources are there for the people that need them when they need them. And I'm just calling out some of the things that we do in JUICE. Like, we have a very nice search feature. So Penny can come in and put in percent anytime she wants a refresh.
That's what I did, percent increase.
You know, so you don't have to go in order and all of that. Also, I was speaking to the points that I think, Penny, you were making or Jamie on mobile and accessible. And although JUICE wasn't designed for ESL learners specifically, the audio narration is good, I think, for people who don't have confidence in their reading, but it's also good for people who have to study in very noisy places and want to wear headphones. So it's just a way to improve concentration for some people. For others, it really is a language assist. And anyway, we're committed to those things. So thank you very much for giving me a chance to talk about JUICE a little bit. We are still piloting, and we're very excited to say we still have opportunities to pilot with programs like other folks in the session today who are in the CDLC. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to start a little pilot with you. And there's no charge up to a certain level, and we've got lots of room to bring new people into the pilot. And I just want to personally thank Jamie and Zoe, because they've been piloting with us, and it was a really fantastic opportunity for us to get a lot more insight, just the kind of things that they're sharing in this session today, which is super helpful for us. So thank you. And would love to answer any questions on the chat or later. Just get in touch.
Thank you, Marianne. And you know, this is another situation where we're just showcasing one particular LTI. And as you've heard in the session before, there are many, many, many of them. And you need to do your due diligence as a teacher, as an administrator, of, you know, finding those tools that work the best for your learners. But this is something that I personally have been looking at for over a year or 2 years now, I think. And, you know, it fits all of the notches in terms of providing that flexible learning environment. It's flexible across many different devices. It provides access whenever a learner needs it. And as we're seeing more and more of the data coming out of the pandemic, of what our learners have discovered is, first and foremost, remote does work. If teachers are well prepared, they have the training, and the learners now have starting to request, I'd rather be able to learn this in an online environment because I need that flexibility. My husband lost his job, or my wife has to work swing shifts. I can't make it to class for a couple of weeks at a time. So being able to provide that for our learners, I think, is helping us see better persistence rates even during a worldwide pandemic. And all of those numbers aren't all out, and there's going to be a lot of number crunching and everything else. But I think tools like this, like JUICE, the LTIs for Google Suite, the LTIs for CK-12, and there's hundreds of them. Please do not think that this is a limit. Mm-hmm. That access for learners and give them the flexibility that they need. So if you are at all interested in exploring JUICE any further, because it is a great tool for your high school diploma students, GED, ASE, ABE, because they can use this to help build their learning skills at many different levels. And as Marianne said, we're even seeing that it's valuable for English language learners because of the audio capabilities. And that's always been a thing for me with accessibility. Mm-hmm. You know, they need to have a way to get this information in more than one form. So right. I'm always pleased to be able to see that. So